Hey, you remember that scene from The Return of the Jedi where Gandalf goes down into Jabba the Hutt's mine and fights the Rancor on the Bridge of Khazad-dum with nothing but his lightsaber? Hey folks, my name is Adam and I like to make tiny nerdy things. Today I made Gandalf versus the Balrog on the Bridge of Khazad-dum. In order to make the armature for the Balrog, I needed to double up my wire, so I wound it around on itself just using my drill. Basically, I took one piece and folded it over itself, put one end in the chuck, and then held onto the other one and just spun it until it was well wrapped around itself. He's gonna have a lot of clay, and he's gonna be pretty top-heavy because of his big old head and his big chunky belly, so I needed to make sure I had something that was going to be able to support a lot of that weight. Now, to avoid having to use all of my clay on making him big jowled and fat-bellied, I used lots of aluminium just to bulk everything out until I was generally happy with the size, and then I can start adding on the clay to at least get my base layer going. Once I've got the body built, I'm gonna start smoothing everything so that I don't need to worry about smoothing while I'm adding all the parts in. It's better to have it all smoothed ahead of time, then it's just adding and removing as I need. Very important part of the Rancor is his brassiere, which as you can see here is a very lacy two-piece. And then we can start adding on the rest of the parts to bulk out things like his tail. We'll add a big chunk around his neck to make sure that he's got a great big head on him. And then we can get started on the facial features. So I will stab a little hole in his face to make the mouth, like a little whistling bit, and then stick a knife in there to open things up, and then stick the end of my brush back in there to really brush his teeth and smooth everything out. Then we can get on to adding the eye sockets in and adding little bits here and there where I think it's going to look good for sort of the random spots where he's got like bumps and little gnarly bits. And we get started on his gums, which are just a bunch of balls, which I'll stuff in there. And then his nostrils, which are my favorite part because there's no rhyme or reason to them. Like, they're so off-centered. If you ever look at a good picture of them face on, they don't line up. They're just super weird, and I love it. I love the Rancor. I think he is a hilariously terrific monster. And the first time you see him in The Return of the Jedi was, it was awesome. Rather than use balls of clay, I'm just gonna use some ball bearings for his eyeballs. I think these are from a pair of old rollerblade wheels. I don't remember where I got them, but they work perfectly for eyeballs because they're nice and round, and with a big head like this, you can jam them in really well. Then all we need to do are all the little sticky dealy bits down at the bottom of his head, and then we can start cutting out bits where his neck rolls will be. Once I was happy with the general shape of the head, then we can start making his belly wonderfully beery. He's got a big beer belly, and it makes me laugh every time I look at it. And then we need some random sort of warty skin bubbles. I don't know what they are, like little pustules of some sorts, but they're part of a skin, so they're, I don't know what they are, but I like them. They add a lot of texture to it, so we'll just stick those on and blend them in as best as I can, and then we can get started on his back scale tail thing. So I'll smooth out a little section here, and then cut a whole bunch of little strips, which I will work from the bottom up so that they are overlapping. And then once they are in place, I'm gonna come back through with some isopropyl alcohol and a brush. And using downward strokes, that will both help to remove a lot of the fingerprints that I've stuck on by handling it, as well as add a little bit of texture to the scales or slats or whatever the things on his back are. While I've got the brush out, I may as well go over the entire body and do the same thing to add sort of a striated muscle effect, a little bit of skin texture to the whole thing. And I'm gonna go fairly thickly here because I want to really saturate it so that I can take this little glove, which has a wonderful texture on it, and just poke him. I'm just gonna poke a lot. You know, a little tip-tap everywhere. And what this'll do is transfer that texture onto his body, which will give it a nice sort of scaly, bumpy texture. Then we can get started on the feet, which are gonna be a couple of balls. And then you blend the balls in and you make little toenails, or I suppose big toenails. Then once I'm happy with the general size of everything, I can start adding some texture in using a piece of plastic wrap and one of my sharper tools, and then I cut some grooves in to add a little bit of like a leathery, skinny texture. And then my favorite part of the entire build was adding all these teeth in, because he goes from being a gummy old man with weird skin folds to being kind of a spooky monster. I'll just add a couple more textures here and there to make sure everything looks natural and there aren't any too obvious smooth spots, and then I will bake it at this point so that I know it is sealed while I get working on the arms. Now, his arms are a pretty key feature of him, so I want to make sure that his hands have got a lot of character to them. So I have made some little thingies out of some more folded aluminium wire, and then I'll bulk up his arms because he's a pretty strong lad, so we gotta give him some guns before we start bulking up with the clay. I was really pleased with how the hands turned out. They're always a little tricky making hands. Ask any sculptor, and I almost guarantee they'll tell you that their least favorite thing to sculpt are hands and fingers. Fortunately, this guy has super gnarly arthritic hands, so it's just a case of getting the general shape and then adding little balls on everywhere. And once I'm happy with the gnarly, weird hand, then I will bake it to secure it in place before realizing almost immediately that this is the hand I want to be holding his lightsaber whip thing. So what I'll have to do is fold those fingers in a little bit more, which will crack them along a lot of the seams, but I'm going to come back through with some green stuff after it's been hardened just to seal any of the gaps. Now, the lightsaber itself I opted to make out of some of this thick straw, which I'll cut into the shape I want, and then wrap the entire thing with a little bit of green floral wire to give it sort of a nice a handle. And then some green stuff I had mixed up, I'll roll onto the tips and use a little bit more of the tubing to give it some random buttons and knobs and just make it look generally lightsabery. Now, the main reason that this is hollow is because I want to run the cable through this so that it looks, well, you'll see in a bit, but it looks terrific and I'm chuffed to bits with how this one turns out. With Rancor done, we can get started on Gandalf. The reason I made the Rancor first is I wanted to make sure that Gandalf was the right size, and I decided using some comparison photos from some books and screenshots and that a 35 millimeter figure would fit the best against the Rancor. Now, I realize that this is a bit more of a draw the rest of the owl type tutorial on this one, but basically, once I'd gotten the body shape into what I wanted, I made the face and baked it in place so that I wouldn't have to worry about squishing anything. I'm also going to bulk out that center where the robes will lay over top so that I don't have to worry about pressing anything in. I can use a little bit of force. And then the robes themselves are just a folded piece of clay that I've squished out really flat. And then each of those folds, once they blend in, will look sorta kinda natural. I mean, you'll see when it's done, but I basically did this all the way through, adding little bits here and there, and then blended it in so that it looked like one sort of stylistic robe. Then I'll add a bunch of little pieces here and there. So I've added a belt on to help hide the seam in the middle and to hold, you know, his lightsaber. Then he's got a little pouch that goes on the back of him, which will act as, I guess, his weed repository, his hobbit weed repository. Maybe he's got his pipe and all that in there as well. I don't know. It's kind of like a wizard man purse.
It's not a man purse. It's called a satchel. Indiana Jones wears one.
So then the last thing to do will be to add his glorious, glorious locks and his great big beard. Just smoosh some in place and then sort of give it a bit of texture, and Bob's your uncle. Then we can get started on the lightsaber itself, which I am really pleased with. So what I did was sculpted a lightsaber and a hand holding it onto a really thin piece of wire. And then I pulled that wire out and drilled a hole so that I could run this itty bitty teeny weeny LED through the center of that. And this will provide the light source for my lightsaber. I was going to add a light to Gandalf's staff, but then I figured with the lightsaber giving off enough of a glow, I didn't really see the need to add any more. Plus, the last thing I wanted to do was have to run more wire down his body. So what I ended up doing for the lightsaber was drilling a hole through the bottom of his sleeve, which I'll then run the cable or the wiring for the LED through. And then I will try and blend that into the folds of his robes as best I can. Now in the future, what I want to use is some of this conductive paint that I have. It hadn't arrived by the time I wanted to get everything put together, so I just did it the old-fashioned way. The lightsaber blade itself is a little piece of acrylic tube that I have cut to length and then sanded so that it diffuses the light beautifully. And then later on, I will attach that using a little bit of resin. And as you can see, I mean, it looks pretty awesome. Then we're on to painting up ye olde Gandalf. I was really happy with painting on this one. I actually took my time and I thinned out my paint. Like the first time in my entire life, I thinned the paint out so you don't see all the brush marks. But while that's going on in the background, I would like to take a moment and thank all of my new patrons. You are literally the wind beneath my wings, and you are helping me to do this regularly and improve the content that I'm able to put out. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. Now, if you would like to be a patron yourself and help support the channel out, you can find the link in the description below. Every little bit helps, and it's all put toward making this channel bigger, better, and more beautiful. And speaking of more beautiful, look at how good he looks. Look at the paint, and I even add a little bit of dust around the bottom of it. I am so pleased with this, and I think that from now on I may take more time to actually do some proper painting in the future rather than just throw it on there in order to get it done. It's less stressful, and I like the end result more. Now, because of the size of the Rancor, I opted to use the airbrush, so I'm going to use this wonderful little airbrush booth to prevent getting paint in my lungs. I'm gonna start with some black paint in all of the crevices, and this will help when I come back through with my overcoats. This will add a little bit of sort of fake shadows everywhere that you would have shadows. Now, the colors that I've used here are brown and multiple types of browns. Fun names though. So there's like Terra, khaki, Beastly Brown. Beastly Brown is a popular one, not necessarily because I like the color, but I liked the name. It seemed appropriate for a beast. And then a little bit of maybe some, I don't know, bone white mixed in there to soften some of the colors. But basically you end up with sort of a brown hued grumpy fella. So what you're seeing me add here are the little elbow patches, which on closer inspection I've decided are probably psoriasis. And the reason he's such an angry looking fellow is because the vast majority of his body is covered in patches of psoriasis. And then of course, when he tries to scratch them using those long fingernails, he either cuts himself or he ends up snapping his fingernails off. And then he's got broken nails. And then Becky at the hairdresser's is always making fun of him for his broken nails. And it's just a horrible situation all around. Once the main coloring is done, we're ready to do all the highlights. So this will be painting the toenails, getting each of those individual teeth colored in, and then painting his little spiny protrusions all throughout his body. And then a dry brush over the scales on the back will highlight all the brush marks. And then the last step will be painting his eyes a nice dark black. Then the only thing left to do as far as he's concerned is I'll take a little bit of high gloss varnish and paint over the eyes and then paint inside the mouth, just to give it a little bit of shine. And then I need to paint his handcuffy chainy thing silver, and he's all sorted. Then we're on to building the actual bridge itself. Now, I could have made the full bridge, but I thought it would be a bit more fun to have sort of a central pillar and then build just a small section that Gandalf will be standing on. Now, what you won't see in the video, but you would get to see if you were a patron, is that this is my third time trying to make this pillar. The first one I made far too big, and then the second one was pretty awesome, except I made it out of plaster, and I didn't realize that it would take weeks for the plaster to dry, and when I painted it, I ended up pulling all the paint off. Like, it just kind of fell off as soon as I touched it, and it was soaking wet. So what I opted for was stacking a whole bunch of this XPS foam on top of itself, and then I will make the bridge out of a couple pieces stuck together, and this is all held together using Fabri-Tac, which one of my delightful subscribers recommended I use, so thank you very much for that. And then once I've got this glued together, I can approach it like you would a tasty vanilla cake made out of foamy butter. So start shaving the sides off, taking the corners down until you've got a semi-cylindrical shape. You don't need to worry too much about it being perfect, because when we've got the shape we're after, we can start peeling little bits off here and there to give it that sort of rocky, crevassy texture. So I start with the large grooves cut into it, and then I'll come back through with my X-Acto knife and some files and whatnot to just really scar it up. I was in the mood for a tiny bit of self-flagellation, so I opted to build a full tiled floor from 3 millimeter thick foam, which, I mean, it looks awesome, but given that, you'll probably never really notice it. I can't help but wonder if this was really worth the effort. Then finally, I'll use a little bit of gap filler to reshape a couple of the bricks and rocks and make sure there aren't any obvious seams from where the XPS foam was glued together. And then I'll add a little bit around the tile work to make it seem like it's sort of one flat surface, and then I went through and added it as if it was a grout. I actually regret this because it hid a lot of the detail of the tiles that I spent far too long making, but hindsight being what it is, all I can do is tell you, maybe don't do that. And then you can tell at this point that we are on to the final stage, which is sealing the entire thing with black Mod Podge. Once that's dried, I've gone over the entire thing with sort of an undercoat of what I like to think of as a warm gray. So it's gray with some brown mixed into it, and then while it's still wet, I'm going to take another paintbrush with a grayish brown instead of a brownish gray and just blend it in so that it gives a little bit more of a sort of a cavernous, rocky appearance. Then we're on to what is always my favorite part, which is dry brush. So we'll go with varying degrees of lighter grays and then a final go over of white. And then I'll paint the tiles on top a lighter gray before adding a little bit of dust via sponge and brown. I don't know what else to say. It's just you sponge on brown and it looks a little dusty. I thought I needed a base to sit on, so I made off camera just basically a hexagon out of the, I think it's a 1-inch thick XPS foam that the rest of the thing is built out of, and then built a ring around it and just pulled out the little bits so it looks like sort of a sandwich of rock and stone, and I don't know, I just think it looks kind of nice. It just fits on there real good and I'm happy with it. The absolute final stage of the painting will be to apply a very, very heavy black wash. I went very heavy-handed with this because I wanted to make sure that every single crack and nook and cranny had a good healthy dose of wash all throughout. Planning is not one of my best traits. I'm not so good with the planning ahead. I'm very much a just start doing it and see how things turn out. And I completely forgot how I wanted to run the wiring past just Gandalf himself. So I ended up having to drill a big old hole down the middle of this foam and then drill some holes through the actual rock to insert the wires. With those in place, I can put Gandalf down and feed the wire down his leg and through his little spiky dealies that hold him in place, and then connect the wires underneath. Once I've made sure that they are wired up properly by checking to make sure the light actually turns on, I've cut out a groove in the rock underneath, which I can press the cables into and then return the sort of pieces of rock that I've chopped out so that it fills that gap, and then just using a little bit of that wood filler, I'll fill the rest of the gaps in, cover up that tiny bit of wire, and then all I need to do is come back through and just repaint it so you don't even notice that anything's there. That way his wiring is perfectly hidden and you'll never even know. Then our final piece of the puzzle is to put the Rancor down and figure out where I want to feed the EL wire for his laser beam whip thing. So the Balrog in the Lord of the Rings has that awesome fire whip that he snatches Gandalf and pulls him down with. Spoilers if you haven't read the book from like 60 years ago. So once I have that run up through the bottom, it can be stuck into his lightsaber and it fits nicely where the cable attaches, so it'll actually hold itself in place. And then it's just a case of reshaping the wire until it looks good, so it's got kind of some motion to it. Then the last step will be that UV resin to hold Gandalf's lightsaber in place, and we're onto the glamour shots. There you have it, folks. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, leave me a comment, hit that like button. If you haven't subscribed, now is a great time to do it. I try and post a new video every week, but it does depend on the complexity of the build. If you hit that little notification icon, you will be alerted as soon as something new does drop, so you don't need to worry about missing anything. Otherwise, we'll see you next time. Cheers.